do this on a mainstream conference, which is actually a valid thing, than doing this kind of talks in a excluded or separate conferences related to accessibility alone. So in next, so in next 30 minutes or so, we will be talking about, Christian has done a wonderful introduction already, but I will just do once again to talk about myself, and then we'll talk about what is currency state of today, and then we'll talk about cards and wallets and digital transactions and so on. Before that, I just want to give you all a quick question I want to ask you all. If I give you all a blank paper and say it is a newspaper, what would be your reaction? Very good, fantastic. So, that could be the same thing which applies to accessibility, which we are going to talk about today. And before that, I, like Srikanth has made some disclaimers yesterday, I'd also make a couple of disclaimers. Firstly, is there a sign language interpreter in this room? I believe no. And if you have, any of you have a hard of hearing, my sincere apologies. You may want to read the full text later, which will be posted on my website. If there are any visually impaired in the audience, I would actually speak out most of my slides, so you shouldn't generally having any problem. So visual impaired could be not necessarily people who have got the eyesight problem, but primarily who would be sitting in the last row. Okay, about myself, I am an accessibility advocate like Christian has mentioned, and I have a day job at Informatica, and I'm also founder of something called Servom Inclusion, which is a platform that I use to raise awareness about accessibility, and not just raising awareness about in a respectable way, but I'm a kind of shameless person to tell anybody, we should together work for accessibility. Okay, I don't mind if other person feels me saying that, oh, this guy is bugging me or bothering me. But as long as it's a consumer application, if there are people who actually use these applications, I do not hesitate to give them feedback. But what I generally do is, I try and give them a constructive feedback so that they not only find a problem statements in whatever I tell them, but also a kind of solution how they can fix their problems. Because the thing, I personally believe accessibility is not something that developers do it intentionally. And guess who do I blame? If a website is not accessible, who do you blame? Who do you blame? Do you blame the developer? Do you blame the product manager? Okay. I don't blame the developer. I actually blame his or her teacher who actually taught them HTML, CSS, JavaScript, etc. Because unfortunately, I wish if somebody would disagree with me, but most of the institutes today which teach you HTML, CSS and JavaScript and so on, or any programming language, they do not talk about U of usability, S of standards, or forget about AF accessibility anyway. Do you all agree, or anybody who would be happy to disagree? So there is no sound, that means everybody agrees, right? Very good. All right, so prior to my work at Informatica, I was formerly, it's interesting, I started my journey into accessibility while I was working for a non-profit organization called the National Association for the Blind, where we have actually created a beautiful website for the organization, and at the end of the day, we realized our own students who are people with blindness cannot use the website. So that is which has triggered me to start working in the area of accessibility, and I started working something called Barrier Break, which is an accessibility consulting firm in Mumbai. And then of course I moved on and worked at various companies like Yahoo, PayPal, HCL. Through them, I got a chance to work with Google. and so on. And since my passion is about raising awareness about accessibility, I also do a consulting activity with somebody like Precat Solutions, Mnet, and so on, a few companies. So I'm open to help anybody who want to bring change in this, in their culture of working, culture of building products. So I'm also an active participant at Accessibility Guidelines Working Group at W3C, and I'm also a member of something called International Association of Accessibility Professionals. Some of them are hidden because the screen size, I don't know what is going on here. But do you all remember, any of you remember this? Any of you have you ever used, seen? Yes. There is a reason why I'm actually showing this old currency. If you actually notice, you will see the different dimensions and sizes in the earlier currency. Maybe 1 paisa coin, 2 paisa coin, 5 paisa, 10 paisa, 20 paisa used to have a different design. 25 paisa used to be very small, and 50 paisa a little bigger, and 1 rupee is altogether bigger, and 2 rupees has a different dimension, and 5 rupees is a thickness. Earlier it was easy to for people to identify the currency. But of late, for some time, now this is a picture I have taken from a change.org campaign, which is being done by some of our colleagues in the industry. Because if you look at the currency of today, forget about people with blindness or low vision. I have seen my mother having a conversation with the auto driver. Hey, you're supposed to pay me 5 rupees and why are you giving me 50 paisa? That poor guy actually gave her 5 rupees coin. Okay? And she was looking at it with her hand and saying, oh, it must be a 50 paisa coin. Right? So, if people who have got all the eyesight and mainstream people are getting confused with the currency, and now thanks to the new currency like 2000 rupees, 500 and new 50 rupees, I don't know how many of you have seen, even the 200 rupees note. It's all, do you think they look like currency or they look like, what, your lottery tickets, right? So, we're all lobbying to work with RBI to bring back the real good currency of different sizes, because no matter how technology is evolved, there are, of course, applications which can recognize your currency and all, but not everyone would be afford to use the internet even today, okay? Or not, they may be aware of how to use them at all, right? So, the problem today is that all the currency coins, if you look at, there is no difference between 50 paisa and 5 rupee coin. There is no difference between 20 rupee and 2000 rupee note, right? So, this is something which we are actively lobbying with the RBI and in Government of India to see what changes can be made. If you ever got a chance to talk to anybody about this, please do so. Do your best, fight whatever you want to do. Let's all together do whatever we can. And now ATMs. ATM is, how many of you don't use ATM in your life? Anybody in this room? Everybody uses. Okay? But, you know what are the problems with the ATMs today? There are, in spite government has the regulations, RBI and IBA has got the clear regulations to for the manufacturers to develop the accessible ATMs. So accessible ATM does not mean only having the talking features, okay? Because accessibility is not just for blind people. If Vasu is standing here and talking, being a person with low vision does not mean accessibility is only for people with low vision, right? It could be for anybody, people who are in the wheelchairs, people who are the hard of hearing, people who have the cognitive disabilities. And I'll give you an example. Now most of these ATMs, if you see today, at some point it will tell you, welcome to Access Bank ATM. And then after some time, after a few tasks that you have done, it will tell you, please enter your secret code. Thank you for using Access Bank ATM. Is this an accessible ATM? Yes or no? Yes or no? I need an answer. No, because it is partially giving you an instructions like welcome messages and all that. But it should, if you're a real accessibility means, it should have adjustable height, it should have buttons that can be accessed by blind people, okay, and so on. So it has, there are the clear guidelines how to design an accessible ATM, okay. And there is also a website called talkingatmindia.org, which is maintained by some of our friends. so that actually gives you, you can locate where is the talking accessible ATM in your area, okay. They maintain the list of ATM, accessible ATMs. The data will be provided by the respective banks, and but for the across the country. Okay, pay using cards and POS machines. So you have heard a lot of things about this point of sale machines and cards and payment gateways and all yesterday, and some of them are going to be today as well. And also that includes the privacy, security and all. So let's see what are the things about these. Cards, you don't need to deal with that inaccessible physical currency, which is a good news. But there are a few things. When you go to a shop, I know in the United States and few countries where you actually do checkout on your own. But does it happen really in India? No, we just go to the counter and give them our card and they will do the calculations and they'll even take your card and they'll swipe and give you, right? So, in that there are few things involved related to privacy. Especially if you are a customer who is a wheelchair user or who happens to be blind. Okay? If you are a wheelchair user, if the counter is height is good enough that you are able to access the machine and put in your own PIN, that's okay, isn't it? But if it's not, you have to spell out your PIN to the merchant, which can be had by somebody who is around you as well. And what if after the transaction is done, if somebody just takes away your card? Who got to know your code? There can be a chances of misuse, right? And if it's a blind person, forget. There is no option but to tell the PIN to the merchant. Because firstly, you don't know what kind of machine that person is using, POS machine. There are two or three varieties today. And you really have to trust that merchant he has entered the right amount. Okay? Because until the transaction is happened, you will not get to know what is the amount made until you get your own SMS, right? If that merchant wisely put the right amount, well and good. But accidentally or intentionally, if you put an additional amount, that's it. You only get to know after you get the SMS. Then you'll have to do all your fights. What could be solutions for it? Like somebody yesterday said, instead of the POS machines, they use the mobile applications, which is a good thing. Because in every mobile phone today, whether you're using Android or iOS, you have a screen reader. If you are using Android, you have a talkback feature, okay, which is ready to use. So you can even ask the merchant, okay, I want to turn on the talkback before I use your application, okay. And the screen reader can come in hand if you are using a mobile application. And if the government regulates or something happens, if you still want to use only the POS machines, then you have to add a screen reader to it so that people should be able to use on their own, and that should have the real accessible buttons. I have also added voice recognition. The reason, because as I said, it's not about only blind people, right? People who can't use their hands, how do they activate? How did they enter amount? How do they use that machines? So they should be able to dictate, right? Yeah. Or if all these things, if you feel that it is an expensive affair, it's not going to happen. Then what you should be doing is, like how the Paytm does, okay? you need to send a OTP to the user, which also has the amount in it, so that you give back that OTP to the merchant, you will enter, done. Okay, so that's a technological solution that you can use. And the reason why I mentioned about the card details to be sent to the user as and when needed, because if I'm shopping something online, I need to check out, okay? And what if I don't remember my card information, right? I want to retrieve my card information immediately. How do I do that? I don't have Braille, I'm blind. So I should be able to send some instructions to my bank using some SMS format or something like that, or clicking on some option. I should be able to get my information in a secured manner, not the CVV code and all, because CVV, it's expected people should be able to remember that much at least. But the card number, the 16 digits or something, that has to be sent to the user securely. Wallets. So we have so many wallets today. Paytm, PayUmoney, who is actually one of the sponsors for this event, MobiQuick, and quite a number of wallets you have. Wallets are in a way very self-serviced. People can use it themselves, okay? But the problem here is that the interfaces are inaccessible. With due respect, since we have reached out using several channels as well, and the public channel, it's good to send messages to as many people as possible. But if somebody from Paytm is around, Paytm Android app used to be accessible until 2 months ago, but now with the recent update, it is slightly broken. So if anybody from Paytm in this room, you should actually go back and alert your teams. If somebody has a connect with the Paytm, you should actually go and do that. Because Paytm is something which commonly uses today across the board, and I almost use it every day, okay? Especially when I ride on the Uber. I just prefer to use my Paytm linked with Uber. And also, I use them with Big Basket. Yeah, now another problem with wallets is, you have a food court here, right? So how do you know what wallet do they accept? Every merchant keep telling you, I accept Paytm, I accept MobiQuick. When you go to the counter, will they tell you? No, it will actually displayed there. But what if a person who is blind, how would they know what wallets are being accepted there? So there is a technological solution I'm proposing, which is actually, in fact, we're planning to do this kind of a hack, as part of a hackathon, which is upcoming in the month of May. So if I'm standing around a food counter, I should get a push notification saying that, barista accepts Paytm, MobiQuick, etc. I should be able to get that push notification. Using what APIs, we need to figure that out. How much time do I have? Enough? Very good. Okay. So we're talking about electronic transfers, like NEFT, IMPS, RTGS, and so all these things. It's again self-serviced, and people, it's actually far more easier for even for people including cognitive disabilities, because you will have a familiar interfaces. You don't need to deal with new interfaces every day, because you might end up using one bank or two banks, but you don't every day, you don't change banks, right? So thanks to whatever reasons, but nowadays, if you look at something like SBI, HDFC, HSBC, and ICICI, a lot of bank interfaces are fairly usable, if not really accessibility compliant, but they are fairly usable. But what we need to keep in mind is that these channels are actually growing. These channels are modernizing. In the name of modernizing, people are actually forgetting the basics and standards. I'll tell you, accessibility is not a rocket science. Accessibility is all about writing a semantic code and adhering to the standards, okay? And now, I will tell you one simple inaccessibility problem of this conference. Okay? Christian has mentioned the people who wear the red lanyards are not to be what? Photographed. Do you know blind people can also take the photographs? Yes. But the technology, it will tell you there are 1 person, 2 people, 3 people or 100 people. But it will not tell you which person is wearing the red lanyard. Okay, so if I have taken a photograph of any of the red lanyard, it's your choice, I can't help. So, it's all about standards and basics, right? So, what people need to keep in mind is that when they're developing the interfaces, they need to make sure they meet the web content accessibility guidelines, or if they are developing the mobile applications. Interestingly, a lot of these mobile developer frameworks, like if you are developing for Android or iOS, there are a lot of accessibility features which are inbuilt. All that, our developer friends has to leverage on them. With due respect, but I have seen, at least to good extent of developers, their mindset is they want to complete the building the product. But can we just pause and see, am I writing the right code? Or even if I'm copy pasting a code, am I copy pasting from a right source? There is nothing wrong in copy pasting unless you are going for an exam. There is nothing wrong. Okay, but you need to copy paste from the right source. That is the reason you have all these open source frameworks, open source projects. You are feel free to copy paste, but please copy paste from the right source. There are a lot of accessibility plugins, there are a lot of accessibility components written which people can reuse. And another problem with these electronic transfers is, it's interesting, it's not the problem of our developers or technologists, it's the problem of banks. So, I have a friend who happens to be blind and who is an advocate. So if he is an advocate, practicing advocate, do you agree that he is a decent educated person? He goes to a bank and try to open an account. And they tell him, you use a thumb impression, so we consider you as illiterate, so we cannot open a bank account to you. What do you do with them? Right? So there are, it's also essential that bank training institutes has to sensitize their employees in dealing with people with disabilities. They need to give them an extra banking facilities, nothing really, nobody is asking for it. But whatever you're giving it to everybody, you should actually give it to people with disabilities as well. And there was also one time banks were saying, okay, if you want to avail a bank account, you come with somebody else and we open a joint account. Well, I am a single, not really, I am married, we have 2 kids. But what if I am a single person who is living only in my family, right? So, this is the situations in the banking sector. But in the whole, if the facilities are given and electronic transfers are far more easy, assuming our interfaces are accessible, are there any developers in this room? Okay. You know, all you need to do is, very simple thing. Well, in the next slides, we are going to talk about using the automation tools and all that. But before that, all you need to do is that, when you actually at the testing time of your product, for 20 minutes, let's say as good as your tea break, unplug your mouse and use your product just using the keyboard. You don't need to experience a screen reader or anything. You don't need to become blind. You don't need to become a cognitive disabled or anything. First thing you use is use your own product just using the keyboard. And you will be able to address at least 60% of the accessibility problems. Okay, the major problems are in this modern application development area is we all use model dialogues, right? the alerts, dialogue boxes, and all you use, right? But do you set the really tab focus onto that boxes all the time? Though the model dialogue, firstly, if it can be accessible, activated using the keyboard, well and good. Once it is activated, your focus has to come onto that model dialogue. It should not remain on your parent window, right? So your first testing tool will be your keyboard. Forget your mouse for about 30 minutes and use your own product or whatever you are using.
Okay.
Yeah. Payment gateways. Again, the accessibility of real-time messaging. So something like, because in the payment gateways, everything happens in the real time. Like in between, you will also show a message saying that do not hit refresh onto your browser. Do not use back button and all that. Okay. If that messaging is not accessible to somebody who is using a screen reader, and if he says that, okay, nothing is happening. If he uses a refresh button or back button, the transaction is gone. Maybe his money he must have deducted already, whatever, right? And another thing is that when you actually showing up a dialogue, something is happening, even when the transaction is successful, or when you're actually asking him to do an additional level of authentication, that messaging has to be exposed to the assistive technologies using whatever code you're using. If it's a model dialogue or a real-time new page or whatever, that has to be exposed. And the reason why I mentioned about accessibility of promotional material. How many of you do receive emails from all these payment gateways? 80% offer, 50% offer, 30% offer, whatever, or 5% cashback. Do you all get these emails? Yes? Have you ever seen that email in a browser which did not load the images? What will you see? Will that be useful? Then that is how a screen reader user will see your promotional material. If you actually send out an email like that, entire content embedding into an image and sending it to a user, and if user is a blind and using a screen reader, all they will see is a one line of single chunk code that talks about a path of your image. That's it. If you call that is a promotion, I'm sorry. I can't use that promotion. So if you want to really, I'm sure there are a lot of marketing teams also sitting here, out here. If you want to reach out to more customers, you have to make your marketing promotional material accessible. And let me tell you guys, to make anything accessible, either your promotional material or your website, you don't need to compromise on design. You can use as beautiful things as you want. Okay, it can be as fantastic, as beautiful, as nice looking, everything. All you need to do is use little brain, take little time, and you'll be able to produce accessible material. And it's also important to generate the accessible invoice or receipts, because as the invoice is as important to you, could be important to people with disabilities as well. It's not about only the payment gateway providers to make their products accessible. It's also important the people who are actually implementing it. Okay, if I am using PayU Money's gateway, I have to make sure that button that they provide or the interface that I create using their platform, I create a accessible interface, okay? It's not necessarily that only my cart is accessible, but the button, I will just embed an image of PayU Money and leave it there. It's not going to be accessible. So it's important for both the parties, whoever is using the payment gateway and whoever is providing the payment gateway. And especially the reason why I've chosen to talk about PayU Money as a name is because I also see a lot of non-profit organizations, especially working in the disability sector, do use PayU Money quite a bit, and especially to raise the donations and all. And I believe they have an interesting to use this as their payment platform. And another reason to use their name is thanks to them for sponsoring this event. Okay, and the redirection. Redirection also need to be seamless. If you are actually redirecting a page which is taking minutes and hours together, it's going to be a problem. So during that process, it has to send the messaging. Okay, what state is it? Like if you are actually installing a Windows software, you keep listening some buzz, right? Why do they do that? Because they want everybody to know what is the status of the installation. Oh. Okay. So, quickly about automated testing tools. there is something called, all of you know about JSLint, right? So similarly, there is also something called aslint.org, which will let you test against your code while you are actually coding on the fly. Our other simple tool is something called AXE, AXE. It's by DQ Systems. All you need to do is right click on the page, go to inspect element, click on AXE. It's a plugin for Chrome and Firefox. Once you enable that, you use that AXE from your developer console and it will show you the number of accessibility issues. Very simple format in very simple language, including links to the techniques. So these are few things which you can do for the accessibility evaluation. These are the simple things. Use the WCAG checklist, which is available on many websites, including mine. And run the automated testing tools, something like AXE. And as I said, use the keyboard alone. Then use the screen, if possible. There's a final thing. You can also start using some screen reading software like NVDA. Is non-visual desktop access is a free screen reader available for Windows. And if you are using Mac, VoiceOver comes for free. So we can have a couple of questions if you want, or I'm available in the office hours from 11 to 1. So we can also talk there. Even if you want to look at something as a demo or something, we can